Church, we're glad that you have gathered together with us to worship the one true God. As we heard about a few weeks ago when we started in the book of 1 John chapter 2, we're being reminded of who we are in Christ, and then this morning we'll be talking about what that requires of us. So as you're turning to the book of 1 John chapter 2, I want you to think about the words that we sung this morning during the hymn. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. I love that part of the song the most because it accurately reflects the Christian experience. I think a lot of times we come into church or we think Christians have it all together and it's just about moral improvement and it's about being better than other people. But I think that song accurately represents the tension that exists for us. Though we are saints, we are still sinners. We still sin. And that's why it's good news for us that our God listens to these songs and is delighted to hear our worship. And so not only do we experience this being Christians as followers of Christ, but the writer of the hymn himself, Robert Robinson, experienced this as well. He wrote this hymn back in 1758, and many years after he wrote this hymn, it is reported that he was riding a stagecoach with a woman. And she was humming this song, and she was just really into it. And she could tell that he was unhappy. And she asked him why he was unhappy. And he said, "Madam, I'm the poor, unhappy man who wrote that hymn many years ago, and I would give 1,000 worlds, if I had them, to enjoy the feelings I had then." So we see someone who composed this wonderful, beautiful hymn himself had strayed away from Christ. But we know that that's not the complete story because she responded and said, "Sir, the streams of mercy are still flowing." And so because this is the God whose presence we enter into, that is why we can boldly live as he has commanded us to live. And so it's important for us to understand, what does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean that we have put our faith in Christ? What does it mean that we are followers of Christ? If you find yourself in a period of wandering or perhaps just spiritual dryness, what do? Do you just try harder? You know, that's a mentality that a lot of times that we have, especially not only in Asian culture, but American culture. If you just try hard enough, you will succeed. Do we just make a to-do list of things we need to do? I know we talk about it a lot, but, you know, we probably put have a quiet time as the first thing on that list. And then, you know, every morning we see the list and we check it off. Is that what we need to do to make sure that we can walk faithfully with God? No. If that was the case, being a Christian would be merely about moral improvement or behavior change. All you would have to do is change your behavior, and then you would be able to walk with God. Rather, we need to remember that because God faithfully walks with us, we are commanded to follow him. And though our hearts are prone to wander, we are called to set our allegiance on God, stir our affections for God, and submit our actions with God. Again, turn with me now to the book of 1 John chapter 2. We'll be covering specifically verses 15 through 17 this morning, but I want to read from starting in verse 12, because I think it sets a foundation for what we're going to undertake. Listen now to the word of the Lord. "I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I am writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I am writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever." Would you pray with me? Father God, we thank you that you have gathered us into your presence this morning, as your people, as your children, as those who have been brought out of darkness into your marvelous light. We ask that as we're gathered this morning that we would truly set our hearts upon your word and what you have for us, and that we would see that being a Christian is about more than merely professing faith in Christ, but it's about the lives that we live in response to what Christ has done for us. Would you allow us to be encouraged? Would you allow us to be convicted, exhorted, and corrected by your word? And would you fill us with your spirit to enable us to do all of these things? And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. So again, this morning we're going to focus on verses 15 through 17, but I wanted to read verses 12 through 14 because in that, John is encouraging these churches of their identity in Christ. As we talked about again a few weeks ago, the context of this letter is that there have been false teachers teaching the congregations that John is ministering to, and many within their ranks have left. And as a result, not only are those in these congregations wondering if what they have is true, but they're also struggling to love one another because they don't know how to behave as a result of some of their supposed brothers and sisters in Christ leaving. And so verses 12 through 14 set the foundation because John there is encouraging that they do know him who is from the beginning, that they have overcome the evil one, and that their sins truly are forgiven. And so as we head into verses 15 through 17, it is again important to note that in the previous first chapter, in about a half, this is the first command in verse 15. This is the first command that we see in the book of 1 John. There are only 10 commands in the whole book of 1 John. So anytime a command is given, it is important for us to pay attention. And so we're going to settle down and go verse by verse. And in verse 15, the command there is that they would set their allegiance on Christ. And so read along with me again, verse 15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So one thing also to think about is the way that John writes often scares a lot of people because it seems very black and white. But it's important to understand that he's stating truths, and the whole point of this letter is to encourage believers that they can have assurance of salvation. And so when he says, do not love the world or the things in the world, we need to understand, what is the world? What are the things in the world? And what does he mean here by love? You know, again, we talked about it a few weeks ago, but we talked about how God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son. But here it seems that he's saying something completely contrary to that. And so we need to unpack what's going on here. Well, first, it's important to note that the world here does not refer to the physical creation. Physical creation is good. In Psalm 24, verses 1 through 2, it says, the Lord has created all things. Rather, it says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein, for he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. And so we see that God created the world. The physical creation is good. It is a good thing to delight in nature. It is a good thing to delight in a wonderful sunset. Or you think about recently, it's been really hot here. When the rain's here, it's a good thing to be thankful that we have rain and that it cools the earth. So clearly, John here is not talking about not loving the physical creation. Neither is he here, again, talking about those who don't know Christ. Again, John 3:16, a commonly quoted passage, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And so there's this thing where we see that we are called as Christians not only to love our brothers and sisters in Christ, but also to love our enemies. So if these things aren't what the world is, what is the world? Well, I think we can think about the world as anything in the created order that does not recognize the authority of God and as a result is opposed to him. Turn with me now to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. And so we see here that we once, as believers, walked according to the world, and we are called to live no longer as them. The reason is because the world is still under the control of the evil one, Satan. He reigns in the fallen world. And so as Christians, we are to live in the world and follow the reign of Christ, because we know that he is the one to whom our allegiance is owed. And so, again, you might be wondering, okay, so specifically, what is the world? Well, as we're going to see in verse 16, he enumerates what are some qualities of the world. I've been making a lot of generalizations here, but in verse 16, he's going to specifically talk about what are the things of the world. However, I want to mention that we need to think about what love here means. Again, it seems like there's some maybe cognitive dissonance going on. Hey, you know, God loves the world in John 3:16, but all of a sudden in 1 John 2:15, we're told to not love the world. Love in this sense means to not set your ultimate allegiance upon. It doesn't mean that you don't love non-believers. It doesn't mean that you can't love things that are in the created order, but rather you do not set your ultimate allegiance upon those things. And why is that? Well, in the preparatory meditation, if you looked at it, it mentions that it's a Gospel of Matthew, and a key part in that is, Jesus says, no one can have two masters. You can only have one master. And so ultimately, if you're not loving God, you are loving something else. If you are loving the world, you cannot love God. Again, I'm using love in the context of which I just defined it as. And so why is that? Well, the love of the Father cannot exist in you. You cannot have love for the Father if you love the world. And we know that the only reason we have love for the Father is because the Father first had love for us. However, whenever we set our hearts upon anything apart from God, we cannot love God, and we cannot say that we do, because our hearts are ultimately split. Our allegiances are split. The idea of allegiance is central in the 2004 movie Miracle, which is a movie about the 1980 U.S. Olympic hockey team and their eventual victory over the Soviet Union, which was a hockey powerhouse and still is. So in this movie, I don't know if any of you have seen it, but in this movie, it's a great movie. It gives you feels if you want feels. I encourage you to watch it. It's PG rated. It's a good movie. And so in this movie, the U.S. traditionally is not good at hockey. Even now, they're not the great at hockey. A lot of foreign players come over. But in this movie, Russia is just been dominating. They've been a hockey powerhouse for such a long time, and the U.S. team is made up mostly of amateur players and college players, which when you compare them to professionals, are not as good. And so the coach, Herb Brooks, is tasked with coming up with a team of 25 players in order to enter into the Olympics. And so as they're preparing and getting ready to play for the Olympics, he has all the players gather, and he tells them to say their name, where they're from, and who they play for. And so they go down the line, one by one by one. They state their name, they state where they're from, and they state most likely the college that they went to or the team they were on at that time. And after that, Herb Brooks makes them do all these different exercises. And so fast forward about into midway through the movie, and this is the turning point in the movie. The U.S. has just failed to play up to their potential, and Herb Brooks notices the players are distracted. And think about it. You've just been playing hockey, which is 3 20-minute periods, you're exhausted. And he sends them back on the ice right after the game. And so they're on the ice, and he starts yelling at them, he starts berating them, he says, you know, you guys are never gonna be good enough to win if you don't play together as a team. Your individual talent alone will not allow you to beat anyone. And so in dramatic fashion, you know, think about the music is rising, and you see they're going back and forth and back and forth, and you see a guy fall down. You see a guy throw up. You just see them. They're all exhausted. They're worn out. And then you even see the guy's like, hey, I need to turn off the lights for the facility so I can clean the ice on, you know, the Zamboni, that little machine. And Herb Brooks says, you know, leave me the keys. I'll clean it up. So the lights go off. They're going back and forth. They're exhausted. And finally, one player stands up. He says his name, where he's from. And then he says, I play for the United States of America. And so that's the point that Herb Brooks wanted to get to them, that they didn't play for their individual teams anymore. Though their college teams had rivalries, now that they were part of the United States team, they played for the U.S. team. And that's all that he wanted to hear from them. After that, he's like, all right, go home. And so, you know, again, it's a really dramatic thing. But I think we need to ask ourselves the same thing. Who do we play for? Or another way to think about it is, who do you worship? Do you worship Maybe your political allegiances, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, is that how you're defined? Do you worship perhaps money, and so your job is just to make a lot of money, and if you fail to make money, you get mad at other people? Do you worship your grades or where you go to school, and that's what your life is about, and ultimately, apart from that, you have no hope? Or are you like me, who really worships control? Control that doesn't exist, but I really worship control. And the way that this comes out for me is driving. I have terrible road rage, and I don't recommend any of you have road rage. But whenever I drive, perhaps some of it is I want to be safe and this person cut me off. But a lot of it is just I get annoyed with people really quickly. And it's either they're going too fast, they're going too slow, they didn't use their turn signal. That's a big one for me. You know, they're merging too fast, they're merging three lanes over at the last second. I just get angry with that. And again, some of that might be out of safety, but ultimately, at that time, I'm worshiping myself, and I get angry. And a recent incident I'm not proud of was I was driving, and this person was in the left turn lane only, and they tried to merge over, and they didn't merge over. And I started honking them, and I started mocking them, and they were mocking me, and I kept honking them. And I was meeting with a guy who is, you know, a guy I'd worked with at George Mason. And afterwards, I was like, man, that is very sinful. That's bad. And, you know, and that's one of the reasons I generally don't have bumper stickers on my car, so you can't tell if I'm a Christian or not. But the problem is now I have a bumper sticker from Missouri Baptist University because I worked there doing IT work. And so I'm like, okay, great. Now people are going to see that and know that I'm a Christian. But the whole point is that's super convicting. That's not the way that it should be. I know for me, I used to do this also, that I would be driving and get angry, and I'd be like singing worship music at the top of my lungs, and I'd immediately turn it off because I'm like, oh, I'm definitely not worshiping Jesus right now. I'm singing praises to Jesus, but my attitude is abysmal, and it's convicting. And so I want you guys to reflect on who is your allegiance to. At the end of the day, who or what do you worship? You know, what does this practically look like? I think, again, as Americans, we're so individualistic. We think, okay, well, I just need to sit down with my Bible and think about the things I worship. That might be true, but as the body of Christ, we need to talk with one another. We need to share things with one another. We need to talk about what's truly going on in our hearts so that we can tell one another, hey, I think grades are too important for you. Or as for me in high school, I remember talking to Pastor Ken, and he'd be like, you know, we just talked about girls for like an hour. I think girls are too important to you. But I need that because I'm blind. I have blinders. We all have blinders. Again, maybe that's control. Maybe that's, you think about, you want your kids to obey you all the time. And when they start crying in the middle of the night, you're like, why can't you just go to sleep? But whatever it is, we need to be open and honest if we're going to accurately reflect the body of Christ and what we've been called to do. And if we miss the fact that our allegiance determines how we live, then the rest of what I'm saying is irrelevant. But if we get that, then we can begin to stir our affections for God, which we will talk about in verse 16. So turn with me now again, focus on verse 16, and read along with me. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. So again, here we notice John is elaborating on what he meant by the world, more specifically. Notice that in the verse 15, he mentioned that if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. In verse 16, he mentions that the things that are in the world are not from the Father, but they are from the world. And so I want us to unpack what the desires of the flesh are, what the desires of the eyes are, and what pride of life is, or pride in possessions is also translated. First off, the desires of the flesh are not just mere physical human desires that you have. John has been talking about and most likely teaching against false teaching, which said that Jesus never actually came in the flesh. He was a spiritual being alone. He only appeared to come in the flesh. And so he's emphasizing, we talked about it a few weeks ago, but if you look at the beginning of 1 John, he talks about that whom we have seen, we have heard, we have touched, to emphasize the physical nature of Christ coming in the flesh. So clearly, it's not just human desires. Rather, we can think about them, as one commentator notes, as things originating in innate human nature regarded as unredeemed by God. So we know that as human beings, we are all sinners. None of us is born as a Christian. We are all sinners. And it is only in coming to Christ that we are no longer in the flesh, but in the spirit. because we know that the spirit and the flesh are hostile against one another. And so these desires could be things that are just sinful straight up, like murdering someone, stealing from someone, or these desires could even be good things that we have corrupted or tainted by how much we want them or when we want them. Food is a good thing. You know, I think we can rejoice in the fact that after this service, we will go eat together. That's a great thing. We can have food. We don't have to worry about going somewhere else. We can have food, and we can be merry over that food. But if food is our God, if we just compulsively eat food over and over and over, or we eat food when we are anxious or distressed, and we use it as a coping mechanism to deal with life's problems, ultimately, we are following the desires of the flesh. Or maybe, again, I mentioned relationships, or perhaps it's a desire for sexual intimacy. Those things in and of themselves are not bad. But if you say, oh, hey, God, I've been waiting 5 years, 10, 20 years to get married so that I can finally have sexual intimacy with someone, I'm tired of waiting, I'm going to take things into my own hands, then you are in sin, because you are not waiting upon the Lord's timing, and you are ultimately, going back to the first point, worshiping yourself, and then you're worshiping the desires of your flesh. So these desires, again, it's not saying that human desires are bad. It's not just saying, oh, hey, I'm hungry, that's sinful. It's rather, if that desire is not submitted to God or in proportion to what God wants, then we are in sin. What are the desires of the eyes? Is it something, oh, you see, you want something and you desire it, oh, hey, you're in sin? No, it's not talking about just you see something that you want it. But rather, back then, culturally, it was understood that the eyes were the gateway to the heart. If you go to Matthew chapter 6, verses 22 to 23, you see Jesus elaborating on this. He says, the eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? So he's talking about if ultimately the eye is the gateway into the heart. If your eyes are corrupted, if your eyes are tainted, the whole body is tainted. Your whole heart is tainted. And so this is saying, if you are purely living according to your eyes, carnally, in a flesh way, I see something, I want it. How does this play out for us? Well, think about it. Maybe you see someone with the newest phone, or a bigger house, or a nice car, or maybe you see someone dating someone you've liked for 5 years, and you're like, oh my gosh, and you're covetous. That happened because you saw it, and in response, you didn't process it, you didn't take those thoughts captive, but rather you dwelled on them, and you ended up in sin. And so the eyes have great moral capacity. The eyes in and of themselves, again, are not bad, but they can lead us astray and distract us and ultimately cause us to walk away from God. What is pride of life? Is this just talking about, hey, I'm proud to be alive? No, it's a good thing to be alive. Life is a gift from God. Rather, the pride of life, or as it was translated, pride in possessions, is anything in life that you find your identity, value, or worth in apart from Christ. So again, that can be pride in possessions, as an older version of the ESV renders it. Whatever you have, hey, I have the newest car, hey, I have the newest phone, hey, I have the best TV, and that's what you base your identity on. And how do we know whether or not we're basing our identity on these things? How do you spend your time? How do you spend your money? Do these things dominate us? Perhaps it's your pedigree. Perhaps it's your grade point average. You have all your diplomas lined up on the wall, and when you walk in the office, that's what makes you feel good about yourself, and you give allegiance to that. Perhaps in Northern Virginia, it's your salary. We know that Northern Virginia is a place where very wealthy people live. And so perhaps you're basing your value, your worth, upon how you live and what you have. And I think even, I was just thinking about a quote that a singer said. He said, you know, I can tell you what your religion is. It's how you spend your time. It's how you spend your money. If I go look at all your Google searches, I can tell you what your religion is. And I think it's true. Again, I'm not saying that every Google search you do has to be a Bible verse or something related to God. But the truth of the matter is, it's so easy for our hearts to go off track, which is why John is reminding them, and by extension reminding us, that we need to not love the world or the things of the world. Some of you might be thinking to yourself, well, you know, I'm doing pretty well. Maybe you're in middle school and you are so popular. Maybe it's high school. Maybe you're a four-sport varsity athlete, which I don't think anyone in this church is. If you are, that's awesome. But yeah, I think I tend to think that our strengths are probably the academic ones or the music instrument ones. But, you know, maybe that's what you're defining yourself by, and you're like, life is pretty good. This is how I make my worth. This is how I get my money. I want to ask you a question. Are you truly happy? Are you truly happy when you meet the goals that you have for yourself? Or when people recognize you by the thing you define yourself by? One of my dear friends has a saying that sums up the folly of sin. He says, sin only gratifies, it never satisfies. It can make you feel good for that split second. It can make you feel good for that 3 minutes, but it will never truly satisfy your heart because that is not what we were made for. Recently, I've only been back for 6 weeks, but I've been watching a lot of Hulu, Netflix, and you know, I watch episode after episode for hours. Maybe I'm staying up too late, and I'm laughing and I'm enjoying this stuff, but at the end, as anyone here who has binge-watched things, which I'm sure many people, you just feel like something's missing. You feel like something's empty. You're like, that was so funny, but I feel terrible. You don't think like, yeah, that was awesome. I watched 10 episodes of the show. Now I'm ready to take on the world. You're like, no, I've watched 10 episodes of the show. Now I want to go sleep because I feel so bad about myself. We're not created for these things. These are the things that we find our worth and identity in, though. And so the way we get away from those things, again, not that these things in and of themselves are necessarily bad, but is we need to stir our affections for God. And we have an example of that in Jesus Christ. If you turn with me now to, again, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4, we see that in the desert, as Jesus was tempted, surely his affections were stirred for God. Read with me now, starting in verse 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to them, all these I will give you, if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. The reason we know that Jesus' affections were stirred for God is he was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And even it makes note that he was hungry. I get hungry after a few hours. I can barely go a day without food. 40 days, that's a long time. And so clearly, the desire for him to be hungry is not a bad thing. But we see here Satan tempting him as saying, well, ultimately, since you're God, you can do whatever you want. Turn these stones into bread. He doesn't do that because he recognizes that Satan is tempting him here. He's testing him. And the point I want to make is, I think a lot of times we think of temptations as things that are so evil that it's so easy for us to identify. Like, oh, I'll never commit adultery. That's so wicked. That's so easy for me to identify. Or I'll never steal or cheat. You know, those things are so easy. But the truth of the matter is, Jesus is being tempted with good things here. Eating is not a bad thing. But he's being tempted to eat at Satan's timing, not God's own timing. Or the fact that Satan tempts him to be safe. Safety is not a bad thing. Satan says he'll give him all the kingdoms of the world. Having the kingdoms of the world is a good thing, but ultimately we see what the problem is he's saying that he needs to worship him. And so as we think about this for ourselves, we need to wonder, what do you want from life? If setting your allegiance upon God is who do you worship, I think stirring our affections for God leads us to ask ourselves, what do you want from life? What are your aspirations? What is the thing that you are living for and cannot live without? That thing, whatever that is, apart from God, will ultimately fail you at some point or another. Because you and I were not created for that. We're created to be lovers of God. We were created to walk with God, just as Adam and Eve walked with God faithfully before the fall in the Garden of Eden. And so our hearts can get so easily distracted. And again, similarly with setting our allegiances, I encourage you, think about what you spend your money on. Think about what you spend your time on. Think about the things you daydream about. That's probably a desire that you have. Again, it can be a good thing, but maybe you're thinking about it too much. Again, for me, I know that recently online shopping has been a bad thing for me. I got up at 2:50 for Amazon Prime Day. 2:50 in the morning, not 2:50 p.m. I got up at 2:50 a.m. Easiest thing in my life to do. I got up, Amazon Prime Day starts at 3. I know a lot of you, maybe it was a bust. It was they sold a bunch of random stuff you'll never need. But I sat there for an hour and a half until 4:30 waiting for something good to show up. And nothing good showed up. And I was like, well, I'm tired. It's 4:30. I need to go to sleep. But that's so easy for me to do because in that moment, I just want to worship online shopping. It's really easy to do. Back then, you actually had to go into a store. Now you can just click a button online, and it's there. And to show about how crazy the culture of immediacy is, I ordered something at probably 3:30 a.m., and it came at 8 p.m. that day. That's the culture that we live in, though. We live with this immediate gratification culture. But the thing is, after you get the thing, you're like, oh, this doesn't satisfy me. Think about all the junk you have in your house that you don't use, and you're like, maybe I'll use this. I was visiting Pastor Ken, and he was getting ready to move to another house, and he was like, why do we have these tennis rackets that are 15 years old? Like, we don't even use these. Like, why do we have this 6 CD changer? You know, he's going on and on, and that's the reality. The older you get, the more things you acquire. And if I look at my own self, there's probably only 5 to 7 things I use every day, but I'm like, I might need this if I get in a car accident. Or I might need this just in case it rains. I might need this. So I need to be prepared for every situation because I want to be the guy who's prepared and can help people. But truly, if I'm honest, a lot of it is I want to be a trendsetter. That's why I use crowd-raising platforms like Kickstarter where you can support someone's idea. I want to be the coolest person to have the newest wallet or the newest water bottle. Or recently I bought an electronic bike and I was like, oh, this is awesome. I can show off to people that I have an electronic bike. But like now that the bike is in St. Louis and my roommate has graciously picked it up, it was 85 pounds, I'm like, it's not going to change my life. I don't even know how often I'm going to use it. But that's the thing. We spend things. We use our resources so quickly as opposed to using them to serve God or to help one another or even just to delight in our times with our families. You know, where we're dominated by a cell phone culture. And so you're sitting at dinner and everyone's on their cell phone and the conversation is weak because we're just caring about the things we want in our own lives. I know I'm guilty of that. And so I would encourage us to think about what are the things that we actually want? Because God is the only one who will satisfy us. And we can keep looking in the world. You know, I've looked 27 years. Maybe you're 11, 12, you're thinking, hey, I haven't looked that long. Go on, keep looking. I guarantee you won't find it because our hearts were made for God. And until they find their rest in him, they will be restless. And so not only do we need to set our allegiance on God and stir our affections for God, but we also need to submit our actions to God. Christianity is not just a faith that talks about doing things. It's not just about a verbal proclamation. Yes, we are called to preach the gospel, but we're also called to live that out. Turn with me again to the book of 1 John, and we'll read verse 17 in chapter 2. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. This is pretty straightforward. You know, we just talked about what the world is. All these things, the desires of the flesh, desires of the eyes, pride of life. The reason we need to not worship these things is ultimately they're going to pass away. They're not going to last. And the contrast with that is, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. You're talking about something that is temporary, something that is transient, something that will fade away versus something that is eternal, that will last forever, that is perpetually going and will never end. Think about forever, the concept of forever. That's a difficult concept for us to fathom because we're finite beings. For some of you older folks, I'm sure you think about things that you could do 20, 30 years ago. You might not be able to do them anymore. Maybe you could lift 300 pounds and run 5 marathons back to back. You probably can't do that anymore. If you can, again, props to you. But chances are you can't. I'm only 27, and if I don't get enough sleep, I am toast. I need to make sure I at least get 7 or 8 hours of sleep. And so this concept of forever, eternal, it's hard for us. We know that people die. Perhaps you've lost someone in your family that's close. Perhaps you know a loved one of your friends who passed away. We know that forever is a hard concept to understand because we know that death steals that concept of forever for us. But I want you to think about it like this, contrasting transient, temporary with forever. We live in a culture, we live in an age where great inventions have been created. Again, this age, this will probably date how old you are, so some of you might not even know the things I'm talking about. That's okay, you can go on the internet and look them up. Back then, there was something called Betamax, which was essentially like a video player. And Betamax was supposed to be the greatest thing in the world. It cost like $600 when it first came out. It was supposed to be the greatest thing in the world, and shortly after it came out, it was replaced by the VCR. Who knows what a VCR is? Does anyone know? Okay, some people know what a VCR is. VCR, okay, so that was supposed to be the greatest thing. VCR, wow, now we got tapes that are longer than an hour. They're 2 hours, two whole hours. Betamax was only 1 hour. And then what happened after that? Then we had CD-ROMs, CDs. Those are the greatest things. Who had a CD player? A lot of you probably had CD players. You're like, yeah, I'm cool. I got this CD player that I can stick my hand in, like hold it and run, have the headphones. CDs were the greatest thing. Oh, no. But then there are DVDs. DVDs are what you need. That's nothing will get better than DVDs. Oh, and then HD, DVD, and Blu-ray come out. Oh, okay, well, then these are the best. Well, no, now everything's digital. Why even get a DVD player? You don't need those things. And so these things were the greatest thing ever. Or if you think about a Walkman, do you know what a Walkman is? You know, Walkman, that was a pre-CD player. That was a pre-MP3 player. You put this, I had it, I remember. It could listen to tape cassettes. They used to sell those things. You go to Best Buy, you can buy a tape cassette. And you listen to the radio. And then they had things, again, CDs. They had MP3 players, sole MP3 players. Now you just have phones for all these things. You have tablets for all these things. You don't need an MP3 player. It's all on your phone. But that's the way that we live. We think that the greatest invention will last forever, and that's how they're always marketed. It's like, you know, I was doing research on it. There was an article called, like, Goodbye VCR. But, you know, I think we can have say Goodbye DVD. Those are going to be obsolete in 10 years because technology keeps improving. Or you think about the monitors that you, computer monitor you have. Those used to be like 30 pounds, and you couldn't move it, and it was terrible quality. And you couldn't put a magnet to it because it'd mess up the screen. Now you have TVs that are super light and super ultra def and high def. But the truth is these things don't last. And so would you still walk around with a cassette player, a Walkman? No, because you can't find any music for it. So I think we really need to think about, are we living for things that are temporary, or are we living for things that are eternal in our lives? Yes, I've just made a mockery of technology. I use technology. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. God has given people great wisdom and insight to create technology. But ultimately, the things that we're living for, if we're living for the approval of other people, if we're living for our grades, if we're living for what our parents think about us or how much money we have, those things will fade. And what else is part of the world that we live in, the fallen world that we live in? Not only are these evil, lustful desires going to pass away, death will pass away because death was never part of the original design. That's not the way that it should be. Death is not natural. Death is something that is unnatural as a result of the fall. And so the wonderful thing of walking with God, walking with Christ, is that knowing in the heavens and the earth that things like racism will no longer exist. Those are desires of the flesh. You see someone, desires of the eyes, you discriminate against them because they look differently. We know that the environment will be restored. You know, we treat the environment so poorly. As Christians, we should care about the environment more than anyone else. It's God's creation. Things like abortion that Planned Parenthood's been doing, those things will end. Those things are not of God. Those things are desires of the flesh, of the world, that will pass away. So there's this kingdom that will fade, and there's this kingdom that will last. And John, and I am asking you, what kingdom will you follow? What kingdom will you walk with? Where will you go? How will you live? Is being a Christian merely putting a Bible verse on your Facebook feed? Is being a Christian merely putting a Christian quote on your Twitter profile? People do that all the time. Celebrities do that all the time. It doesn't mean anything. Anyone can put Philippians 4:13 on their Twitter feed and say, oh, I walk with Jesus. And they misuse a verse also. But the thing that we have is a great treasure that will never fade. And so some of you at this time might be wondering, what's a hope for us? That's a lot to do. I have a hard enough time getting up in the morning and brushing my teeth, eating breakfast. I'm sure a lot of you skip breakfast. I have a hard time getting my kids out of bed. I have a hard enough time getting my kids to church. They don't want to come, or they're sleeping. What's the hope for us? How can we do these things? Our hearts are those that are prone to wander. Our hearts are those that are prone to leave the God that we love. But our hope is in the one who never wanders from God. He never leaves God. And his name is Jesus Christ. And that is why we can gather this morning and rejoice in knowing that walking according to God's ways, yes, they might be difficult. Yes, we might fail. But ultimately, our hope is not in our performance. Our hope is in the perfect performance of Christ. That's why we're gathered. Christ entered into our brokenness. He saw you when you were a slave to sin. And he said, I am going to save you. I am going to save you from slavery and bring you into my family. I will clothe you with robes of righteousness, and you will be co-heirs with me, and you will have life that never, ever fades. That is the good news. That is why we can live as God has called us to live, and we know that his reward is worth it. Pray with me, would you?